So in this video, we'll be talking about problem number 3 from the 2021 AP Calc A, B, and BC exam. This is a non-calculator question, and this is a question about the toy that's generated by rotating the region that you see graphed right here about the x-axis. So they tell us that the equation of that function that we rotate to generate this toy is given by cx times the square root of 4 minus x squared. They do tell us that c is a positive constant. And they do go on to say a little bit later on that both x and y are being measured in inches. In part A, they ask us to find the area of the region in the first quadrant bounded by the x-axis and the graph of y equals cx, square root of 4 minus x squared, for the c value of 6. So what I did over here, and we're going to need this throughout the next few portions of the problem as well, so I did it without putting 6 in place of c. I wanted to know what these x-intercepts were, and it's pretty obvious that this first one right here is 0, but the way that you confirm that, you know, this is a factored form of the function y, and if I set the first portion equal to 0, c doesn't equal 0, so x has to equal 0, and that's obvious from where that graph begins to work its way up off of the x-axis. Seems like it is at the origin. The other one, the intersection over here, is going to be the x value, the positive x value, that makes the square root equal to 0. And that's something that should be pretty easy just to kind of almost guess and check. You can do algebra to find it as well. But if you put 2 in place of x, 4 minus 4 is going to give you 0 under the root, which gives you your other 0. So 0 and 2 are going to be your limits of integration throughout, because those are going to be your x-intercepts for this function. So what I did is I took a vertical slice of this region, and I thought about the height of this vertical slice was going to be the equation that they give us as the top y value, the y value sitting here, or for any other slice that I could have chosen to draw. And then the bottom y value is always going to be at the x-axis, and the y value at the x-axis is, of course, 0. So the area of the slice would be, if I'm approximating it as a rectangle, would be this height times delta x is the width. And if I want to add together infinitely many of those slices' areas, I'm going to have to use an integral to do that. And I account for all possible slices by denoting the limits of integration of 0 and 2. That accounts for all of the slices that I could have potentially drawn between the x value of 0 and the x value of 2. Now, if you get to this point, you do have to watch out for this integral. It is a u-substitution that you're going to have to carry out. So notationally, you're going to have to make sure that you change your limits of integration from the values of x that you start with to the values of u that they turn into. You can pause the video and kind of follow through my steps here, but you should end up with an answer of 16. You can definitely leave your answer looking like this. You don't even have to do this canceling of the threes. The three that I have out here canceled with the three that I got through my antiderivative. One other thing that you might notice that I've done here is I've left off the negative that's on this line when I wrote out this line. And what I did is I swapped the limits of integration. My zero kind of got cut off on the bottom of the screen here. But you can always change the sign of your integral if you flip the limits of integration. And that's the only thing I did to get rid of that negative. I flipped the limits of integration so I don't have to worry about it anymore. In part B, you are told that the derivative of this function is given by this fraction. And for a particular toy, the radius of the largest cross-sectional circular slice is 1.2 inches. What is the value of C for this particular spinning toy? This is pretty tricky. You have to visualize the toy being generated by rotating this region about the x-axis. If you do that, it should be pretty obvious that every vertical slice that gets rotated about the x-axis is going to generate a disk. And so the biggest cross-sectional circle is going to be generated at the largest y value that sits within the first quadrant there. So the maximum radius is going to occur when y is its largest value within the first quadrant. And that's something that's, I guess, kind of tricky to realize. You just have to kind of visualize it and think about how the radius is related to the two-dimensional graph. And what that is going to allow you to do is recognize that if the largest radius is 1.2, I know that if I put 1.2 in place of y, that this is going to have to be true at that largest radius. The other thing that's going to have to be true at the maximum radius, at the maximum y value, is my derivative is going to have to either be 0 or undefined. Now, we're going to have to make sure that it's zero. So I basically have the top of my derivative set equal to zero. Yes, this derivative is undefined at the x value of 2, but that is clearly not within the range of values that we should be considering here. We should be considering values between 0 and 2, right? Between the x-intercepts that we identified a few minutes back. And so if I set this numerator equal to 0, what I know is I know that c is not going to equal 0. They tell us in the problem statement that c is a positive constant. C is not going to equal 0. If c equaled 0, you'd have a flat graph for y. Right, it wouldn't actually move up off the x-axis ever. So c is not going to equal 0, so that must mean that 4 minus 2x squared is going to have to equal 0. And if I solve that, I end up with x being equal to the square root of 2. So how does that help me find the value of c? Well, I know not only do I have to have a critical number at this x value that we just identified, but at that critical number, our radius has to be 1.2. So when I plug square root of 2, the x value that gave the derivative a value of 0 for the numerator, when I plug that value in place of the x's in the equation that we highlighted a few seconds ago, what I end up with is I end up with the algebra being carried out amounting to 1.2 being equal to 2c, and therefore c is going to be equal to 0.6. Definitely kind of tricky, quite a bit more visualization than a free response question would typically have. Hopefully what we've discussed here makes a decent amount of sense to you. And then the last part of this, and I'm going to have to double check this. I'm posting this without really confirming whether or not what I've done is correct. I'm fairly confident in A and B. I'm not used to getting answers quite as crazy as I got for part C here. So I might double check my work, try to confirm with some other people's work as well. But I want to find the volume of the spinning toy that gives me I want to find the value of C for the spinning toy that gives me a volume of 2 pi cubic inches. So I'm going to just try to find the volume of the volume of this three-dimensional object that I would get if I rotated this region about the x-axis without specifying a value of C. And so we talked earlier in part B about the fact that any vertical slice rotated about the x-axis is going to generate a disk. And the radius of that disk would be the top y value, which is the y value from this equation, minus the bottom y value, which is still 0. The volume of one of these disks would be pi r squared times the thickness of the disk, which would be delta x. If I want to add together all possible disks volumes, I'm going to use the definite integral as a tool to do that. You do see I've done some simplifying as I wrote out this line here. When I square this radius, I'm going to have, now I can only get away with doing this as long as it's multiplication between my terms, and it's c times x and then x times the root. So you see that I've squared my c, I've squared my x, and when I square the root goes away. So I haven't distributed the exponent because I didn't move this into anything involving the operations of addition or subtraction, but I have done some simplification here. And from there, what I can do is I can take these pieces that do not depend on x, the pi and the c squared, and I can factor them out in front of the integral. Now, I do have to distribute my x squared into this set of parentheses in order to be able to find my antiderivative. And after doing so, I should be looking at 4x squared minus x to the fourth. When I find the antiderivative of 4x squared, I'm going to copy the 4, add 1 to the exponent, divide by the new exponent, subtract off x to the fifth, right? Add 1 to the exponent, divide by the new exponent again. And then I have to evaluate that at 2 and 0 and take a difference. So when I do that, I don't get something that's very nice, right? I get what's in this set of parentheses right here. The nice thing about the non-calculator free response section is you don't have to do any simplifying. And I didn't want to waste time finding a common denominator and trying to simplify that. So my answer is going to look a little bit goofy here. And I'm not used to free response question answers looking quite as nasty as this one does, which is why I might have to go back and adjust part C here. But if I have this as my volume without specifying C, but I'm trying to figure out what the value of C is, if my volume is 2 pi, I set my volume equal to 2 pi. And then to solve that, I didn't really have a lot of room here, so I did my algebraic steps kind of all on one line. I divided 2 pi by the set of parentheses and by the pi that you see here, and then I took a square root to isolate c. And that is the value that I've gotten my first time through. Like I said, I'm going to double check this. I'm not used to answers being quite as ugly as this. The good thing is you don't have to worry about simplifying this at all, but a pretty ugly looking value for C.